Good afternoon, everyone. I am Pramila Shinde. On behalf of Shanankar Kachchi Engineering College, Mumbai, welcomes you all in session 2 of refresher program on developing secure IoT applications. We are glad to introduce the speaker for our next session, Dr. Joanne Gomes. She is professor and head of information technology department at St. Francis Institute of Technology, Mumbai. She completed her PhD in the year 2014 from SNDT University, Mumbai. Her thesis titled Digital Modulation Techniques to Optimize the Quality of Indoor UWB Communication. Her research interests are wireless networks, embedded systems and IoT, artificial intelligence and data analytics, and solar technology. She is recognized research advisor in Mumbai University, and she is guiding 3 PhD research scholars currently. She has 18 years of teaching experience and 13 years of industry experience. She has many research grants to her credit from AICTE, Government of India, and Mumbai University. She has published many national and international research papers in journals and conferences. May I now request Dr. Joanne Gomes to start this session, ma'am?
Yeah, thank you, Pramila. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, just a minute. I need to share my desktop. So just give me some time, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Good afternoon, all dear participants, and welcome you all to this presentation on circuit simulators in IoT. Okay, so before my this lecture, I just joined 5 minutes before, and I was seeing wonderful videos around, you know, and ma'am was showing some about bots and all, and you really feel very nice to look at all those things, right? But you have more joy when you design such programs and such projects and when they start working, right? So in this session, we are just going to see how can we start designing small circuits using Arduino, but without actually having hardware board in our hand. Okay, so all of us must have noticed now during this pandemic time, we all were at home and taking lectures remotely, right? Online education was going on, teaching learning. So during such time, most of the time we had problems related to the subjects where you have hardware related practicals, right? And if it is electronics branch, there are many circuit simulators, paid, unpaid, right? And we know PSPICE is one of them we use, right? If it is a we use MATLAB programs to simulate some circuits. So there are many simulators available when it comes to electronics also. So are there any simulators if I have to do some IoT by using some board like Arduino or Raspberry Pi? Okay, so this lecture is all about studying about such simulators and what are their limitations and what is advantage, how it is advantageous to use this simulator. Can they help us in online teaching learning? Can we show students some experiments? Can we make them do some experiments like that? Okay, so I'll just cover a few simulators in this particular session. Okay, so probably you must have started in the morning and you must have studied what is IoT. So, but just to have a feel of it, you know, you must have break time, lunch break was there. So we just revise few things about IoT before I go to simulator, okay? So I'll be demonstrating maybe one or two applications in one, two simulators. And if you understand that, then you can always carry on any experiment on that, right? Okay. So coming to what is IoT? So basically it is a network of physical objects that are smart. Okay, so why I call those objects as a smart? Because we have to make them smart before they are connected via some internet, via some network. Now, why we have always connectivity between objects? So that they can communicate with each other. They can transfer some data to each other. Okay, so Internet of Thing in very short way, we can say that it is just a networking of smart physical objects. Now, physical object could be any physical object around us. It could be just a cupboard, or it could be just a pen, or it could be just a watch, or it could be anything, literally anything. But if the device or object is not smart, we cannot connect it to the, we cannot communicate with that. So what brings the smartness in the object? So that object should have some input and output and some brain, right? So object should be able to sense some input, some environmental input. So we can add a sensor to that object, some kind of, let's say, temperature sensor. Then that object will be able to sense the temperature around us, right? Now, if depending upon the temperature, if that object has to react on environment back, right? Some decision has to be taken. Then for the decision making, okay, whether something to put on or off, okay, some decision has to be taken. So you need some kind of intelligence, some kind of processing capability, which is given to that object by some kind of microprocessor or microcontroller, right? So that physical object is dumb if it doesn't have any kind of processor in it, right? And then only having sensor input and processor is not enough. You need to also act upon something, right? So you need to have some output device for that object. So usually relays are commonly used in your IoT, okay? And relays have a switch. Relay can be controlled, and the switch of the relay can be made on and off. And then through that switch, we can make something else on and off. Just a minute. Kevin Zavala lecture. Okay, so we have input, processor, and the output. And that is how we have made the object smart. Now, these smart objects, once it becomes smart, we can now connect them together. And then that becomes a network of smart physical objects. And now these objects can interact with each other and transfer some data from each other, right? And we can use this network effectively to perform some task, you can say. So in short, IoT is nothing but a connection of physical objects via your internet. Fine. So I have just, whatever I explained, I have just put one example here. So let's say a physical object as a lamp. Now we know the lamp has an on-off switch, and that we have to put physically on. So then there is no smartness, right? If we have to just physically put on and off. Can I make this switch smart? So if I make switch smart, the lamp will become smart. Means, can I put this lamp on smartly? So how can we do that? So as we say that it should have some sensor, it should have some output, and it should have some processor. So what about if I put some board like Arduino to this my lamp, and I connect the switch of the lamp through relay switch. So my Arduino controller will just put relay on and off, and my lamp will come on and off. But now it is a control on and off, right? So my microcontroller is controlling the process of putting switch on and off, so that in order to put lamp on and off. So that way I can just put some circuit here, Arduino based circuit, one relay output, right? And I don't need any input sensing. That will be conditional. I mean, if it is a dark around, you know, around us, if environment is dark, so you can send some sunlight, light effect. So if it is dark, then put relay on. So when I do conditional sensing, when I have to put output something conditionally, then I have to take input from the environment, right? So to the Arduino, then I can add some sensor, and I can say, if there is no light outside, then operate the relay, right? So now into my system, initially I could just add Arduino and relay, and Arduino Pay, I could have some, you know, another control, and I could control the lamp. Or I want it automatically controlled by some sensor input, then I can add sensor to my Arduino board, and that sensor will sense light there or no, and accordingly it will switch your lamp on and off. So done, I have done a part of IoT here. What is missing is only I have done, I did not need there any kind of Wi-Fi connectivity or internet connectivity, right? So, but I have done automation of the lamp. So suppose now in this situation of putting automatic lamp on and off by using Arduino, if I want to have a Wi-Fi connectivity, I don't want to put Arduino ke upar some switch on and off and then put lamp on and off. I don't want any physical automation. So I want to have some Wi-Fi. So I can use RFID, I can use NFC tag connected to my device, and I can control this device then through my mobile. So if my Arduino has facility to get connected to RFID tags, to sense RFID tag or NFC near field communication technology, or if my Arduino even has some kind of connectivity to Wi-Fi, which Arduino itself doesn't have. You know that if instead of Arduino, if I use Raspberry Pi, it may have inbuilt, like Raspberry Pi 3 comes with inbuilt Wi-Fi connectivity. So if I use Raspberry Pi based and output GPIO connector, you must be knowing it, right? So if I connect relay to that, then now my Raspberry Pi can connect to mobile, and through mobile, I can connect this lamp via my Raspberry Pi board or Arduino board with some Wi-Fi dongle in that. Okay, or some Wi-Fi chip in that. Okay. So this I call it as a locally controlling my device, my object. Okay, locally controlling with wired and without wire. So if I have a without wire, then I can use technology like RFID, NFC or Wi-Fi, right? And if it is a Wi-Fi, I can use my simple mobile. And on mobile, I will have some application like our student use Blink application, which is very famous for IoTs. So if I put Blink application on my mobile and I can communicate with my Arduino via Wi-Fi, and then I can remotely switch on and off my lamp. So now this is by using either wired or wireless smart lamp, we can say, okay, automation of smart lamp. Now what if some other person, let's say if it is my lamp at my home and I'm not nearby lamp, I'm not at home and I want to control it from my office, then we know that I need to control remotely. Now here where IoT comes into the picture. So my mobile is not at home, so I'm in my office. So now if my Arduino board or Raspberry Pi, whatever I have used, whatever processor I have used to make this lamp automated, if that processor is somehow connected to the internet, either directly or maybe you are connected to your mobile, something GSM, or there's some another mobile at home, or you are connected Arduino to some computer, let's say at home, and by somehow this Arduino has got internet connectivity, then I can access that particular Arduino attached to my smart lamp, okay, or attached to my lamp. I can access that via mobile from the office. So to have IoT happen, we need to have internet connectivity, okay? So then what we did here locally by mobile, by using Blink app, same thing could be performed by using remote mobile in the office through the network, through the internet. But for that, I need to have the circuit that is connected to my lamp to have internet connectivity somehow. It should be recognized on the internet, right? So that is what is all IoT all about. Okay, now when we talk about IoT, there is a internet involved, as I said. So obviously then if there is an internet, then there could be some kind of cloud there on the internet, and you might involve some kind of cloud computing in that case. So all such things come under Internet of Things. Okay, so that is what the word suggests. But when I talk about my topic, today's topic, that circuit designing using simulators. So are there any simulators which allow you to really simulate such internet capabilities? So no, we don't have such simulators available. Except MATLAB is currently supporting that you can have your Arduino board, but it needs your hardware. Connect your Arduino hardware to your MATLAB, and then MATLAB has some processes which it will run, and it will directly send your data from Arduino board to your ThingSpeak. That is, it's one of the cloud server used for your IoT application, and it is free. So currently only MATLAB is allowing you to have such internet connectivities outside your software, but again the disadvantage of it is you need a hardware to be there. Okay, so when I talk about circuit simulations using simulators, basically we are only considering a part of IoT. Okay, maybe I just making a lamp smart here, my device smart, checking the circuitry by attaching sensors, your output devices, some kind of processor in that, and I do some circuit simulation and make sure my smart device is working at least with the wired thing. And we know it's obvious, once it is working with wired connection, then the matter is only remains what, either add connectivity to Wi-Fi for remote for local remote control, or add internet for far remote control, right? So only controlling act remains aside, which will involve the internet. So once you do the circuit simulation, more than 50% of the part of your IoT is done, we can say. Okay, and hence most of the simulators which are available, they allow you to draw a circuit, okay, check for certain things and simulate those circuits, write the code. And what more we need to teach students, right? We need to tell them how to design these circuits and how to make them work, and what are the kind of sensors available and what are the kind of actuators available. All these things we can easily teach with these simulators. So here I have mentioned one thing, that things in IoT could be any devices such as heart monitoring implants, or they could be biochip transponders, okay, on farm animals usually they use. Then automobile sensors, okay, they have built-in sensors there. Nowadays many smart vehicles have come. So actually thing could be actually anything in this world, any real thing, okay. Okay, so basically this Internet of Thing was coined by or introduced by Kevin Ashton. He was actually doing, I think, some experiment on supply chain optimization in Procter and Gamble company, and there he realized that we can have actual things, you know, communicate with each other. So this concept was not new that time. This concept already existed in 1970. That time they called it as, I think, embedded internet, or you know, you must have heard M2M communication, machine to machine communication. So he just extended that concept and said that we can use internet. We can use internet for connecting these devices. Till that time, till IoT was introduced, internet was only a connection of people basically. Okay, it was through your computer, people were connected to each other. That is simple internet term. Internet is only connection of people. But when he said Internet of Things, so now he meant that machine to machine communication via your internet. Okay, so that is how this Internet of Thing idea was explained or introduced by him.
I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Minimize the window.
That bottom right corner, there is a small window, ma'am. That window, if you could minimize.
Yes. Okay, fine.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, welcome. So in the next slide, I thought like I will just explain you certain things, the difference between them. We have heard all of these things, and actually in Mumbai University syllabus we have something called IoE also, right? Internet of Everything, IoT and IoE, right? Then we also have heard something called Industrial IoT and Machine to Machine Communication, I just explained. So those are all are related terms, but still they are different in some ways. So for example, as I said, when I say M2M communication, which is in the small way, just two machines communicating with each other, right? So I can say just two Arduino boards communicating with each other. My one Arduino is one device, second Arduino is second device. So it is just a direct communication among themselves, but just two devices, end-to-end communication. There is no third device involved. Okay. Now, when I see industrial internet of things, it means a similar concept. Like in when I say IoT, it is internet of things. But when I say industrial internet of things, it specifically focused on making your equipments, industrial equipments, smart. Means can we monitor those industrial equipments? Can we automate them? Can they be controlled via a web? Okay, so all such concepts are coming up. So they separated out all industry-related applications where all the automation of industrial products comes under actually industrial Internet of Things. So they are not where IoT talks about all general things. It could be household things. It could be your body area network. Okay, any kind of sensors and actuators combination for real things. Whereas industrial internet is only for industry things, and industry 4 standard was developed to standardize this industrial internet of things for manufacturers, for manufacturing industry. Okay, now there is something also called web of things. Web of things actually doesn't have it doesn't directly mean internet of things. Okay, it just refers to a set of software architectures, just a technologies, okay, that support this real world object to be connected to the internet. So web of things only a set of software architectures, styles and programming patterns that are supported or that are available in support for IoT. That is called as a web of things. And as I said, internet is nothing but a internet of people. And what is internet of everything? So it is more broader term. So it includes all this, okay? So it's a bigger umbrella, you can say, an internet of everything. It's not only industry things or other physical things, but it says a person can be also a one of the object in your internet of thing. Okay, so person can communicate with device can communicate with device. There could be some processes as a part of communication and data. So they say some 4 components: people, process, data, and your object. Okay, so internet of everything means now anybody can connect with anybody. There are people also involved, their processes also can talk, something like that. So this is somewhat difference between M2M, industrial IoT, IoE, and internet of things. Fine. So how IoT works? So as I said, just in short, we'll just repeat. So we need sensing. Right, IoT is basically result of many technologies. Okay, it is not just one IoT is not just one technology. It involves many other technology like Wi-Fi, cloud computing. Okay, many communication like RFID. Okay, you may have LoRaWAN technology, Bluetooth, GSM, satellite. So there could be many technologies involved. You may have some technologies for information processing, right? For actuation, you may have some technologies for user interfaces, for creating user interfaces. So it's a combination of various technologies. And basic things we have is sensing, as I mentioned. You should have a connectivity, communication, and cooperation between these objects. You should have something called information processing. So either on board or on cloud, you should have some actuation to act upon, to perform some activity, some action on the environment, right? And you should have some user interface in case some information has to be made useful. Okay. So that is all. IoT works. For IoT to work, we need to have all these things. So I have just given here some cloud platforms which provide IoT related processing. Okay, so there's a long list, but out of this, very few are free. Okay, so ThingSpeak is one of the free cloud platform which does all the processing for you free of cost, right? And in teaching learning, basically we use ThingSpeak. Maybe someone else will speak in some another lecture about it. Okay, so continuing how IoT works. As I said, IoT, this communication basically happens through internet. But if I want to just have a communication in local area network, so kind of mini IoT, but without using internet, but I can have other technologies, right? So I can still check the remote controlling of my devices. So in that case, the first one was device to device. Either they are connected directly, or I can use some kind of Zigbee connection. So there could be a wired connection between two devices, or there could be wireless connection. So here is like one example that one fridge is there, one oven is there. So these two are objects, and a fridge wants to send a recipe to oven based on what are the things available in the fridge. So right. So I need to do gives a smartness to this device, smartness to this device, and they could have wireless communication between them. So right. So now this Zigbee is one of the technology, and I could, as I mentioned, there could be many technologies we can use for this purpose. Then there could be device to cloud. So I have my device, let's say some sensor temperature sensing is done from the device, right? And I need to display it on my mobile, or I need to control back from my mobile, which is not in the local network. Then my device should be connected to the internet, and then my mobile can access that device via internet, right? So that is a device to cloud connectivity. The third part is device to gateway connection. So it means I don't have any means for my device to connect directly to the internet. So I need some third party in between. So for example, these are my IoT devices, maybe my home, my building. Okay, and I have some sensors, actuators, some processors already placed here. And now there is some, maybe in this building, my room is there, and I need to, let's say there's a lamp inside that my room, and I need to switch on and off my that lamp. Okay, so now this my building, obviously everything, all sensors, I should be connected to my internet. Then I'm here in the end user office, and I need to connect, or maybe my husband there somewhere else, my children there somewhere else, right? And they all need to do something, some action to control my home. So, and I have no direct means to connect internet, or I have to connect through some device, then I have to use a gateway device. It means my network is different than the end user network, right? Indirectly, in the computer network language. So when I have two different networks, I connect these networks via gateway. So now my device will first get connected to the gateway, and gateway will connect it to the internet, and then internet can give me access to my device via the gateway, right? Now, when your IoT application is very huge, such as smart city or smart building, where there are many users, many rooms, many houses, right? And a lot of computation is required, then all this computation across this Internet of Things network, it is divided, right? So some processing can be done at gateway level, some processing is done at device level, some processing is done at cloud level, that is on the internet, right? So it could be a distributed processing. So basically, when we say about IoT of devices, it could be one of these combinations, right? So when we say circuit simulations, basically we are just working locally, because as I said, simulators currently at least don't provide through the simulator directly access to your internet clouds or internet connectivity. So here onwards we'll focus our discussion to basically a local communication, or in the local area network, by maybe using wired connectivity or using wireless connectivity through some technology. Fine. So since this program is all about security, IoT, and developing applications, IoT applications with security, right? So is there any security involved at circuit level or no? So before going to that, we know that OSI layer structure, and then OSI layer was reduced to then TCP/IP structure, right? Which we study in the network. And basically these are the five layers of TCP/IP. TCP/IP protocol, and IoT also have similar kind of layers, and you may find different diagrams for IoT layer structure. Okay, So different people portray it in different way, but down the line, basically they combine this physical and data link layer together, and they call in IoT language, they call it as a, this layer is a perception layer. Okay, then they combine this sometimes network and transport, and it's commonly they call it as a network layer. And then they have a top end application layer, right? Now this application layer ke saath some of the authors may show a middleware layer. Okay, so there will be some kind of middleware which can help you to do some processing. Okay, then there could be many other different kinds of layers. So depending upon the application, they may change this layering structure a little bit. But down the line, there could be main three layers. One is perception layer, okay, where your sensors, actuators are dealing. Then if you want to use the internet, then connect to different network, then you need different network layer. You need IP addresses for that. And if you have some application which is running, needs cloud computing, then you will have application layer also in your IoT application, right? And so as if I say it's a perception layer, then you can see there are many physical objects I have shown here. Some medical objects, it could be lamp, could be smart vehicle, smart ambulance, smart home, smart watch. So this is my physical layer basically, right? And physical layer also has a data link layer combined into it. Why? Because I need to have some kind of communication at the local area network, and that is what is provided data link layer. Which layer provides that? So which layer my Zigbee works, Bluetooth works, or Wi-Fi works, right? So they all at basically in the local area network at data link layer. Okay, they need not go for network layer connectivity for that sake, for connecting two devices. So all perception layer basically has your smart objects which are connected with some sensors and actuators. So kind of temperature sensors, or actuator means my sprinkler is connected via some relay type of switching, smart switching device, right? So now if I want to have like, as I said, machine to machine communication, that I want to sense the temperature and control my sprinkler in my home garden, let's say, right? Then what will I do? Then I will use either Wi-Fi technology or Zigbee technology, right? Or Bluetooth technology, or RFID, or NFC. There could be many technologies. So all these technologies, when I use to communicate my sensing, let's say then I need to use some IoT processor, I mean some processor board which can sense the temperature, process the data, and send the signals to my relay to control the sprinkler. So I need different technologies like this mentioned. So all this happens in the perception layer, and I say I'm controlling things locally. Okay, and I don't need internet in that case. Okay, going further, now if I need to control my sprinkler, not by the temperature sensor, not by maybe via mobile as I showed in the previous slide. Let's say I'm using Wi-Fi technology for local control, and I have a board there, a processor board which senses the temperature and controls my relay. But now my that processor board I need to control by Wi-Fi via my mobile, right? As we said with the smart lamp, right? So now that was local control, and we said some another example that now my mobile is in the office and I want to remotely control. Then obviously now my sensing, whatever is there, should go, if I need some cloud computing, so it should reach to the topmost layer. I don't need only temperature sensing. I may need to take the decision based on all past temperature, maybe entire week ka temperature. I'm doing some kind of harvesting, maybe some big project, smart agriculture project. Then now somehow I need to sense, take this data, and via my Arduino, I need to send it to my cloud, okay, such as a ThingSpeak, where I need to plot that data. Okay, so he may be a farmer, the user may be a farmer, maybe an engineer who just want to know what is the progress of my, you know, how was the temperature changing in my field over the past week or over the past month. So I need to plot it, and based on that I need to do some processing, I need to do some action. So once I do the processing, decide, then you know I can send the action back to my Arduino board and can control that final device, right? So in this case, my processor board should be connected to the internet, okay? And all my traffic then of my device, it will have then all the rules of the internet or the computer network subject will be followed, right? So it will go via gateways and it will have some IP address. It will follow, you'll have to choose the TCP packet or UDP packet, right? And when it goes to the cloud or internet, you may have to use some kind of analytics, some middleware will be present. So as I said, some people will show this middleware as a separate you know, layer here. Some people will also show TCP IP as a separate transport layer. So finally, what we should understand is how this works, how IoT works. Now coming to the security, so where exactly in this IoT, now this one application which I explained, like controlling the sprinkler, where exactly at what points we have a security provided? So basically in IoT, security is provided only by higher levels, higher layers we can say. So mainly there is a application layer that is cloud security, and at the network layer we have network security provided at gateway router level, okay? And if you see physical layer security, at the board level, processor board layer, we don't provide any security, but we provide some kind of security at data link, right? That is your encryption and decryption. So most of these technologies, ZigBee and Wi-Fi, these all protocols, what we say, they have some their associated protocols, right? If I say wireless technology, then it is a standard 802. Personal area network is 15, right? 15A is a personal area network Wi-Fi technology, or your standard 802.11, which we use in the house, right? So those all technologies have their own protocol sets. ZigBee has its own protocol structure. So they're in their protocols, when they have access control, there they provide this encryption and decryption facility, where your all data, suppose if I have two devices connection, M2M communication, maybe my temperature sensor is connected to, let's say, one device. And based on that device, I need to control my sprinkler, which is connected to another processor board. So both the things, sensor and actuator, is not connected to the one board, but two separate boards. Now I need to have communication between these two boards. So I need to have some kind of wireless technology. Maybe they are not so close by, that wires can be put in between. So in such case, when data is transferred from one device, one Arduino board to another Arduino board, then Wi-Fi technology or ZigBee technology will provide with the encryption of data. Okay, and the protocol structure handles for us. So that is how the physical layer security is provided in terms of only your encryption and decryption. Fine. So as I said, IoT uses many other technologies also. So I mentioned your wireless technologies or internet technologies. Besides that, it uses MEMS, micro electromechanical system technology. Okay, because of the MEMS, it has been possible to, you know, to manufacture the sensing devices as thin as possible, as tiny as possible. Okay, so you must have heard about mobile nodes, MOTs, what we call, okay, which we actually put it in the agriculture field, right, which has everything on the board. They have input, they have output, sensing, actuator, processing capability, memory, power, right? So we call it as a MOT. So that MOT technologies become possible due to MEMS. Okay, also actuators, the relays, you get very fine. Okay, surface mounting technology, what we call. So nanotechnology is involved, right? And all other these wireless technologies, as I mentioned earlier, and the latest one is this LoRaWAN technology, right? And cloud computing also, not very old, right? It's quite latest technology, fine. So there are many technologies. Now coming to a smart thing, I already mentioned a smart thing, what it is in many of the slides, but just to summarize, a smart thing is one which can identify itself, which can communicate, has a communication capability, can interact smartly with other device. Okay, it could have some human or machine readable name. It should have some name. Mainly, it should have some computing capability. Okay, and it may process. It may possess some kind of sense. Okay, as we said, it has a sensor, so it should have some kind of sense present with it. Right. So main thing is identifying. It should have some unique name, identity of self. Okay. Should have input output, computing capability, and should be able to communicate. Fine. So these are some examples. Okay. So here it's a smartwatch example. Here mobile is controlling some fridge-like device, right? Some machine, maybe coffee making or water making machine, right? And with the watch, we know smartwatch is a really fantastic invention. It does everything nowadays for us, right? So it involves so many technologies to have IoT enabled in it, right? So diagram is not very visible, but then you can always Google. You see how smartwatches, what all things they do. So all that is an example of IoT, we can say. So these are some other examples of thing. Google smart glass is there, right? You have fitness belt, your Fitbit fit monitoring, activity monitor belt. And there are many things, hearing aid, smart hearing aid. All these are, health related innovations, or Google smart glass is another innovation, which all are IoT based. Okay, so now when we said things are smart, let me see what's the time. I'll go a little fast. Okay, so when I say things have to be smart and it needs to have some processor or some microcontroller, then when we have to tell this to our students, or when we actually have to implement, simulate certain things for designing of some IoT application, and we don't want to go real industrial like production where they are going to manufacture some mod, and they are going to have some stringent specification. If we don't want to involve all those things, we want it education related, then a smart thing or anything can be made smart by microcontroller board or microprocessor board. So we have many boards for that available in the market to facilitate or to study the Internet of Things applications. So some boards I have mentioned here, there's a long list of boards, but which commonly we use is Arduino. Since long I'm talking only Arduino. You have something called ESP8266. So this is basically a Wi-Fi chip. Okay. And it itself works as a smart device because it has got one pin, analog pin, to sense something from the environment, we need to connect sensor. So let's say temperature sensor. Now sensors can have various categories. I mean, they could be categorized into digital sensors or analog sensors, depending upon what type of output they give. So if they are giving digital output, then that sensor, that suppose temperature sensor, is a digital. Then it has to be connected to your GPIO pins, general purpose input output pins, which all of these boards have, and many of you might be aware of it, right? So all the digital sensors have to be connected to the digital pins, and all analog sensors have to be connected to the analog pins. So basically my boards, if I need to sense something to have some smartness, then it should have digital pins as well as analog pins. And most of the board have that. So this ESP8266 board is basically a Wi-Fi board. It provides you wireless connectivity. Okay, but it also has maybe some 7 to 8 digital pins, input pins, which work as a hands basically. And it has one analog pin. So you can connect at any given time one analog sensor to your ESP8266, and you don't need any other board like Arduino or something. So this itself can act as a smart thing and connect to, so I can have communication between two ESP boards, right? Or I can control the relay connected to my digital pin of this ESP board via my mobile wirelessly. So my mobile will wirelessly connect to this ESP8266 chip, and through my mobile, as I said, I will have an application on mobile. There are many applications available which facilitate you to control IoT related things. So Blink is one of the very useful application which is free of cost, and from the Blink I have a facility. Once I connect wirelessly my ESP device, then on my Blink application, I should actually put the snapshot of it, but anyway, on that application, once I connect my ESP to it, I can choose my digital pin related to ESP. It will show me which pin you want, D0, D1, D2, D3, up to D6 or 7, some 8 pins will be there, let's say. Right? And then if I have connected my relay to pin number D4, let's say 4, pin number actual 5, because we start with D0. So I want to control D4 on and off. Then from my Blink, I choose D4 and I just say D4 put on and off. Right? Similarly, I can sense the input connected to, let's say, my analog pin, and in my Blink application, I can have a display on which that sensor temperature, let's say if it's a temperature sensor, then the sensor data could be displayed on my mobile. So I connected to my device smartly by my phone through some app, and I'm able to control whatever is connected to my relay, right? I did the smart thing. So my smart device in this case is my ESP board. Now coming to Arduino, which we usually use in all our educational institute, is why we choose ESP, or now why to choose another board if ESP does all the things. So each board has got its advantage and disadvantage, right? So for example, here there is only one analog pin, but what if I'm doing like my student has to do project smart irrigation, right, or smart agriculture, whatever, and I need to see the soil temperature, or you know, moisture in the soil, and some sensing. So I need more than one sensor to be connected, and let's say all of them are analog, or I have 10 digital sensors. Now then there is a limitation on this board, right? It doesn't have 10 digital pins. I need some pins for output, some pins for inputs. I need more than one analog pin. Then we switch over to some another board. Then let's say I go to, then we have to see whether Arduino is feasible. Yes, Arduino has got many, around 13 digital pins, six analog pins, right? So a capability is extended of the board. But it also has a disadvantage. It doesn't have its own way of communicating with other boards. So if my Arduino has to send data to some another device, I need to first make Arduino more smarter. My Arduino is smart, no doubt. It will be smart because if I connect the sensors, actuators, and my processor is computing. So to some extent it is smart, but then the level of smartness is not that much that it can transport the data now. So what to do now? So I have many options. Then I will switch to Raspberry Pi board. Okay, so now my Raspberry Pi board also has some, let's say, 8 analog pins, and some, it has total 40 pin connector, right? So it also will have some, let's say, 18 or 20 GPIO general purpose input output pins, and it has its own Wi-Fi inside, or I can connect through USB Wi-Fi dongle. So now it is more smarter than my Arduino. Okay, so actually speaking, Raspberry Pi has only digital pins, and it has a communication capability. But what it doesn't have is, it doesn't have analog pins. So I'm stuck up. So if I have to use Arduino, it has analog pins, digital pins, but now nothing to communicate. So can I connect this ESP board to my Arduino board? Because it's very small board. So I will have a serial input output pin, RX and TX, usually it's pin 0 and 1 for my Arduino. I will wired connectivity between these two boards, right? And now my data will be relayed from sensor to my Arduino, Arduino to ESP, which is connected with wire to my Arduino. And now from here to another device via maybe mobile, or maybe to another Arduino board connected with ESP. Now between two devices, I can have wireless connectivity, right? Something like that. And if I want to use Raspberry Pi, it works as a full-fledged computer because it has more capabilities like computer. My Arduino cannot work as a computer. Okay, it's just a simple microcontroller board, okay, with some smartness in it. But my Raspberry Pi is full-fledged single board computer. What it doesn't have is, in addition to computer, it can act as a microcontroller board with digital pins. It can have all kind of protocols, CAN bus, I2C, right? Whatever communication technologies are all available with my Raspberry Pi board. So now if I want analog pins, then I need to connect Arduino to my Raspberry Pi board, or maybe some analog to digital converter, ADC, which will provide at least 7-8 pins, and then ADC will communicate by some means to connect it to the digital I/O pins, some wired connection between them, right? So likewise, each board has got its own advantages, disadvantages, and we need to choose them according to our application. So down the line, we are talking about circuit simulation at physical layer, and to have some smartness, I need to attach some processor board to my actual real life thing. So if I want to make smart lamp, then I need to connect one of these board to my lamp so that it can have input, output and processing power, right? So coming to circuit simulation, now we said sensor and Arduino board. So I hope I gave some overall idea how at physical layer all things work, right? Before we go to internet connectivity. So as I said, there is a soil moisture sensor, some temperature sensor, some water pump control you want to do, right? So these are output devices, these are input devices. They are connected to Arduino. I said I connect ESP8266, and then now any other device I can connect to this. So let's say I have a computer, and if my computer has got inbuilt wireless Wi-Fi card, has capability, then I don't need to connect ESP to my computer. My computer can directly now talk to ESP8266 via Wi-Fi connectivity. Now in this scenario, so here I showed board because let's say some of the old computers don't have Wi-Fi card. Then I need to connect another ESP board to my USB terminal. Right, so I have now two ESBs, ESP8266 boards, which are Wi-Fi chips basically. So my Arduino now can communicate with my computer via this 8266, right? So, and data transfer can take place. If we don't want this Wi-Fi connectivity, we can directly connect our Arduino by some cable to USB and have data transfer done, right? And your computer can have some front end. Okay, if computer has some internet facility, let's say, then it can also transfer your data to the cloud. So this data transfer is basically referring to your local data transfer in local area network, whereas this side data transfer is via internet outside your network, right? And instead of having all these things, if you want to avoid, and if you have inbuilt Wi-Fi for Raspberry Pi, you can replace Arduino board with Raspberry Pi also, okay? Now, instead of computer as a device for a front end or for providing connectivity to internet, farmer can use mobile, right? Let's say a user as a farmer. Then it can have some application, a user interface designed for mobile, and via my ESP, my mobile, I can connect to my Arduino via this ESP board directly without involving computer. Now my mobile once connected to my Arduino board, then my mobile can connect to the cloud, right? It has connectivity to internet via its GSM card, right? So likewise, we can have number of connectivities done, and or data processing or data storage or data visualization can take place, right? So when I say data visualization on cloud, it means I'm opening some ThinkSpeak website, but where I'm observing, either it on my either on my computer or on my mobile, right? So besides this, we can use GSM module. You get many number of modules which you can connect to your Arduino and make your device smart in various ways, okay? So via GSM also we can connect to mobile in case you don't prefer this Wi-Fi connectivity. You want cellular or cellular connectivity to use. Then in that case, such modules also are available. Okay. Now in this side, I am mentioning that though in laboratory or in general way to simulate any circuit, we use board like Arduino or Raspberry Pi. In real industrial IoT, if you have to go, then we use MOTS like this, smart devices which are on chip and they're very small in size. And that is why in Mumbai University syllabus, you see along with IoT, we have IoT mini projects, but you also have in, I think, sixth semester, a sensor network lab. In that lab, basically you talk about, you know, Contiki, Kuja, and in that case, we use this MOTS. And Contiki or Kuja, Contiki, I think, is the operating system for these devices. So you need to put that OS on these devices. And Kuja is a software simulator which simulates these MOTS. And I think some Iris, iRead, or Mica is one of the examples. There are many MOTS available and they're very, very costly. Okay, since they have everything on board what is required for doing IoT, they are very costly. And you must have noticed, in case you are developed for your lab, one chip cost around 8,000, 10,000 and so on. And hence, if we have to teach students in teaching learning, we usually don't go for MOTS. So in your syllabus, MOTS also you will simulate, or you may buy few MOTS just for demonstration purpose. So using Arduino boards basically facilitates same thing, exactly same thing what MOTS can do is done. Only thing is MOTS are mobile. They move in the fields, okay, where they are deployed. And in our case, these are Arduino boards or Raspberry Pi, they are not movable, they are immovable. But rest all data processing, sensing, actuation, connectivity, transferring data, all that code remains same. Okay, fine. So I will skip this slide, nothing more to say. So coming to the Arduino, so I'll be showing you some circuit simulators using Arduino board. Or basically, since this is a very popular device, mainly used, comes less than, we can purchase it for less than 500 rupees. So these are the pinouts, okay? So as I said, there are 13 pins, which are digital pins, 0 to 13. 01 is reserved for transmitter receiver. And these are the pins with multiple functions. Okay, so basically we want 13 digital pins. And you have around 6 analog pins this side, A0 to A5. And there is power, 5 volt, 3.3 volt and 2 ground pins. So these pins are important. And one more thing is important. There is inbuilt LED which is connected to pin 13, which we'll be talking about. Right, there's one more ground available this side. A reference is with respect to ADC, which external reference for ADC, which you are not going to use. So there are power pins, analog pins, digital pins, serial pins, as I said, transmitter receiver pin 0 and 1, and SPI related pins, okay, serial parallel interface for communication. There are SPI pins, as well as I2C communication pins, which we are not going to see. Fine. So now on, what is exactly, what do you mean by an Arduino simulator or any kind of simulator? So it is basically when I don't have a board in my hand, a hardware, actual hardware with me. So I need to use a virtual representation of that board and perform experiment. And that virtual representation should act as my real Arduino board. So when I build a circuit around that board, which is virtual board, I should be able to code it, simulate it, and it should give me some results. So that is all called simulators. So all simulators, again, how we have various boards, unless there is some disadvantage, no one invents simply a new thing. Similarly, like with boards, you have simulators also. Every simulator has some kind of advantage, some kind of disadvantage. So overall, if you talk about simulators, what are the pros, what are the advantages of them? So best thing is they can use for teaching and learning. Okay, teaching and learning some IoT platform. So now when I say smart things like Arduino boards or Raspberry Pi, a commonly used term for them is IoT hardware platforms. They are hardware platform. So if you want to teach and learn things related to some IoT platform without having internet connectivity, then a simulator is the best option. Okay, it's much easier to find with this simulator any wiring errors. So if you short a positive and negative terminal of your power supply, you know the simulator is not going to burst out. Like the way it will happen in your laboratory, if student shorts the 5-volt supply, plus minus of Arduino board, right? So certain things means it's not dangerous, like, you know, you can make errors there, and these errors can be easily found if your circuit is not working. So if you have a messy wired circuit on Arduino board which you have done in the lab, it's very difficult for students to find which wire I connected wrongly, which is not put actually in the, you know, which is not actually getting connections, just open wire. So that messy thing is not there with the simulator, so you can teach them or we can learn them very easily. Plus whatever designs you make, you can save them, not like the hardware. You cannot save a wired circuit just like that and keep on using other boards, right? Here you can save your designs, you can share them with students, explain them different concepts using those simulations. So the disadvantage could be every simulator has got some kind of set of components which we may need some sensors or other electronic components, and you know, so there could be shortage of those components, because you know each component they need to write a program on the back end. So there could be limited components, one or two sensors each simulator may have. Okay, and if at all a simulator is having a really good number of sensors, like temperature sensors which is inbuilt, which you can really simulate without having the hardware, you know, that your that some TMP35 some sensor comes, like, so you don't have that actually with you, but then you want to simulate those that sensor connectivity to Arduino, then such some simulators may have that, but then they are not free. So free simulators may have just one or two sensors and actuators. Okay, and internet or Wi-Fi connectivity may not be possible to simulate in your simulator. Okay, so while doing circuit simulation, we need to first design, prepare and connect our hardware circuit on that simulator platform. Then once you do that hardware circuit, then we need to code it. So there'll be some facility to write your code, which could be if your Arduino board is there, then Arduino code. So the again, the code could be done in high level language like C++, then you need to have some kind of compilers, or you can have assemblers. Okay, assembly language code you can do directly, which can convert it to the hex code. So you know, if you write code in C language, then you need a compiler which will convert it to first assembly code and then to hex code. So there could be a chain of compilers and assemblers which can actually, you need a hex file which can convert to the hex file, and that hex file is basically put it in your circuit chip, and then we third parties we simulate the functionality of actual hardware. So there are plenty of simulators available if you search on the net. Few of them I have mentioned, so we can categorize them into online simulators and offline simulators, right? So again, there's a long list of online simulators. Some of them are paid, some of them are free. So I have just mentioned online simulators that are free for use. Again, there is again some more are there, but since I could not operate on them, means I did not like them personally, they have a lot of disadvantages. So but out of this Tinkercad and WalkVee, okay, these two simulators I'm going to show you one example so that you understand them and you can utilize them for your teaching IoT to your students. And one of the offline simulator, now most of the offline simulators are not free, you have to purchase them. Some of them are free, but this Vitronic simulator is good simulator, but then it costs some $11. Proteus is best, you know, you can Proteus, you can do everything for all the branches. If your college has Proteus, then it's best option, since it has got many sensors and many libraries. Basically, you need to have Arduino libraries to support all the sensors and actuators. So Proteus has plenty of libraries, but since it costs in lakhs, it has to be purchased at college level. And then one of the free offline simulator is SimulID, okay, which again I will take one or two examples in that. So going quickly, I think I have maybe less than half an hour, so that much time should be enough for me. So coming to my simulator, so first of all, I should have a centralized place for my program. So we must tell our students, all your Arduino programs, keep it at central folder. We know that if you use hardware Arduino board, which we connect to our USB of our computer, and through USB we can program it, that time we need some integrated development environment for Arduino board, right? So we have Arduino IDE, which is official IDE, and in that IDE we write code, we compile that code, and then we say upload to our board. So this is a very basic procedure which we use in the lab. So all other simulators which are available can really be connected to your Arduino IDE. How? That's I'm going to show. So first thing, keep your all programs in your IDE itself. There you compile them, check them, then transport them to any simulator. That becomes easy. Okay, the very basic simulator, online simulator for ages people are using now, I mean students are using, is Tinkercad, and it's very easy simulator for them. They can just have a fun with it because it is used even at school level. So I will show you, all of you might be knowing it, but I will still show you one simple circuit. Okay, so it will have this, when you open it, initially you don't have all this. You have, your focus is on 3D designs. Okay, so you have to log in, you have to create your login. Once you logged in, you have no designs available. So you click on the circuits, everything will be empty. You just create a new circuit and then it will give you some platform, some components. Okay, so this is a Tinkercad, is an Arduino simulator. So it will have in the components your board, breadboard, and if you want to provide a supply, then this breadboard has a positive line and negative line on both the sides. So you need to use this power supply in the Tinkercad, right? And then when you click on the code, you can write your code there, and start simulation will simulate your circuit. So we'll see it shortly. Now there is another online simulator which is very good, which is voted the best simulator of, I think, of 2020. So this I recently found. So this WalkWee simulator is again free online, but its structure is a little different. I mean, it has all ready-made programs available, but a user has a facility. If it is, let's say, blinking of LED, then it has a circuit available, code available. You just have to click the run. You can use that for teaching students, and you can tell students now how you can change this circuit. So instead of pin number 13 LED, can we put on LED at some another pin? So I will be shortly showing you that. So WalkWee is a simulator. Again, it's online. So you need internet for Tinkercad. You need internet for this simulator also. So they say you are able to draw the circuit, but then it is little painful. Okay, I will show you. Actually, I won't be showing you drawing circuit. I will show you how to modify the existing circuit. Fine. So you need to go to this walkwee.com, or specific Arduino related libraries are available at Arduino libraries, this particular web page. Okay. So the first home page interface of WalkWee is like that, and you have seen many programs already designed: a calculator, a blink LED, a dice roller, okay, electronic safe, electronic lock, right? And a keyboard keys, recognize a keyboard key, or LCD interface, right? Some serial monitor coming, serial communication, alarm clock, real time clock. So all these programs, you just have to click and run them. We will see that. So if I click on Arduino Blink, I get two parts. So now here actual Arduino is not present, but it is showing me a pin of Arduino. So we have to assume that Arduino board is connected and pin 13 is connected to my LED, and another terminal is automatically connected to the ground. So I have to just run code and see the LED is blinking, and I can change the code. Same way you have keypad with Arduino. So we will see actually how this works. We'll skip all this. Then when I go to Arduino library, there are certain sensors implemented. So I was very fascinated by this, you know, the DHT sensor, DHT temperature sensor is available there. I can just start the running of the application and control the temperature or humidity part. This program is similar program what we do in our lab with actual hardware. Okay, we can modify this program and run the program again. Okay, Proteus I will skip since it is a proprietary program, but like this is just one snapshot I had put. Like I had some version of Proteus from my college, so how PIR sensor was connected, and you know how you can simulate a sensor with Arduino board. You can have waveform generation, check it with oscilloscope, you can connect LED. So all this can be done also in Proteus. Vitronics, as I said, it costs some $11 to $15, and they also have the board and all through all the menus. Here you have to write the program, and they have typical, you know, if some of you, if you have used the kill simulator in olden days for ARM processors, in kill simulator we used to have some windows, tools, input, output, right? And some another window like this window opens, right? So we can see memory. So different windows open here through this. So that kind of simulator it is. And if it is digital pin coming on off, so this particular pin here will become red and black, red and black. So analog pin also here, see analog pins, its connectivity shows 0 to 1023, that is 1024, so it's a 10-bit ADC, right? So all these things can be, then there could be some input. When you click on input output, you will have some sensors maybe which you can show. You can define a pin, there'll be sensor here, just tell which pin you want to connect. So these pins will indicate Arduino pins. So something like that simulator are available, and this particular simulator is not free. Then there is one free simulator I'll be explaining quickly, that is SimulID. And then I think next all slides I have just put 8-10 programs, because SimulID is free and you can really use it for, you know, showing different programs. So I'll be sharing this PPT so you can go through these programs and really try on that SimulID. Okay, so after doing this, I will now come to the actual simulators. So since everyone knows Tinkercad, we just begin with that. Okay, as I said, we need to have Tinkercad login. So you can log in through your Gmail ID. Once your login is created, then you get blank screen like this, and your focus is on 3D designs. Okay, from here you have to come to circuits. Once you say come to the circuit, now I have created number of circuits, so you say create new circuit. Okay, so it has by default some very funny name. You can go here and you can really change this name and say a program one. Okay, why it's not changing, but anyway, we'll just see. So here there are libraries available for different elements. You can say all, and all libraries are available. You can just want basic, then basic library will be available. So for Arduino we need only basic library. From here you just have to drag and drop. This is your platform for designing the circuit. So let's say you have an Arduino board. Okay, you can take it, and once you connect 5-volt supply or 3-volt supply to this Arduino board, here one indication comes. Okay, so you have board, and then for the supply we need a breadboard. So you can take breadboard and you can just drag and drop, you know, the lines like this. A 5-volt I can take like this, and you have to leave your touchpad. Okay, and stop here. Then it creates one joint, you know, here. So I'll connect 5-volt here and just click on this. So it got connected. I can just pull this wire and see whether it is connected or not. Okay, so once this connectivity is done, then I say ground. Okay, so I take ground pin and I can connect ground, so to this ground line. Okay, so it is connected to ground, something like that. And then we have some program. Let's say I want to just say blinking of LED, right? So I need some LED, so I take LED from here. Okay, and in this LED it shows, if I click on this anode, this side is the anode, right? So I need to connect anode to my 13 pin. Though I have inbuilt LED, this also will glow. Let me connect one external LED. So I need one resistor for that, for current control, right? So let's keep resistor here. Okay, let's see whether it is connected. No, so I connect my anode to my resistor. a register to pin 13, okay, and ground is present here itself, so I can just say ground. Okay, now one thing you have to keep it in mind that this ground and this supply is separate from this supply and this ground. So a commonly made mistake in Tinkercad is I want to connect this LED, let's say, to the ground. So I'll connect this to this ground, but my Arduino using this positive negative supply. So in this case, circuit will not work. The LED will not show glowing. Okay, so this ground has to be connected to each other like this. Right, then only my ground is connected and my LED will be in the common ground. So my circuit ground has to be common indirectly. Right, so this is now my circuit is done. Then I go to now code. So by default, when you click on the code, the blocks kind of coding comes, which is for basically school students. So there will be some blocks available like if then block, for or setting variable block. So instead of that, we have to switch to text. So you just say text here, continue. Now, when I said, now I have to write a program. Instead of writing program here and then compiling and wasting time to check, I said we need to use Arduino IDE. When first time you download the IDE, you get this symbol on the desktop, right? And I double click on this and you open this Arduino IDE, where actually we need this IDE for burning the program, right? So I have already some open programs. So let's say blinking of LED was one of my program. So in this program, we have, so it's a high level language. So we have setup as a one function and loop as another function. So everything is initialization of your variables or your devices, your LCD device or your sensor, your input output pins, your serial communication. All this should be initialized in the setup loop. And actual reading, writing, maybe sensing, actual sensing is done, displaying, printing, all this done in the loop. So loop is another function. And before setup, you can declare a variable. I have declared one variable here, integer type of variable. Name of the variable is LED pin and equal to 13. So 13 number. So I'm saying in my setup that LED pin number 13, which has a 13 value, make the pin mode as an input or output. So this is the standard statement of our Arduino program. Pin mode is a command. So LED pin make output. So which LED pin it will make output? So pin number 13. Right, and once I make output, I need to make it high or low. So digital write is a command which I use in inside the loop and I'll make it high or low. So that is the understanding of basic Arduino program. Now once I do this program, we know in the sketch we have verify or compile. Right, so before you verify a compile, I think you must be aware that in the tools we need to, now my Arduino Mega is selected. In the tools we need to select the processor first, okay? So I need to select my Uno board, Arduino Uno, or I may use Nano. And in that, if I have, see, it shows now Uno. And with respect to Uno, I need to compile the program. Then only your program will work there in another simulator. So that could be another mistake can happen, using different board and compiling for different board. Okay, so now I'm just making this LED high and low with a delay of 1000 in between. So basically 1 second on and 1 second off. Okay, so I have compiled it. It shows no error. Then I can copy from here and I can put it in my Tinkercad. Okay, so I go here in the code and I can just simply replace this. Right. Once I replace it, I can just say start simulation. Okay, so after doing start simulation, you can see here I can just click on the code. This code will get hidden. This also I can right click, I think. Okay, no problem. I selected a wire, so this remains here. I'll just stop it. I just deselect this wire. Okay, and I start simulation. Okay, so now even my external LED is glowing as well as internal LED is glowing here. Now I was talking about, let's see if I don't have this link, I delete this link and I start the simulation. What happens? So see here, internal LED is glowing, but external is not glowing because these two grounds are separate. Okay. So we can design different circuits like this. And now let's see. I don't want internal pin 13. I want to use pin number, let's say 7. So I connect it to pin 7, right? And I go to code. And since I have defined my pin at only one place, I change 13 to 7. Now I come to my simulation and I say start simulation. Wait, I'll just deselect this wire first. Yeah, I hide the code and I start simulation. It won't start because I have not joined this ground. So I'll just join this ground, some wire from here to here. 1 minute. I have to stop simulation and then the wire will be available. Okay, so ground to ground I connected it. Deselect the wire. Oops, it is connected. Yeah. And if I start now, see, now LED is glowing, but now my program is changed. I modified in a small way, but I made changes in the program. Right? It means changes in the program means my program is working and my LED is glowing. So that is how we use every time we can say new circuit, create new circuit, save it with some name, and add components, add code, and start the simulation and do the circuits. So all our students basically enjoy this Tinkercad, and you can also do nowadays advanced thing with Tinkercad. If you see, I have some programs written for PIR sensor, you know, LCD. I'll just see any LCD program. Yes, we can connect this LCD board to our Arduino. What's the time? Oh, okay. And I can just say this program is already written. Again, how did I write my program? Through the code, right? So hello, good morning. It may not be so much visible. So I have code written. I imported this code obviously from my simulation. So there will be some various LCD demo code. So in this LCD demo code, I have written LCD code and I just compiled it here, checked it, and then I transported it. Okay. So that is how I kept all my codes at central place, and I can use those codes for any simulator. They work. Right. There is also, I just go to this. There is also a motor and PIR sensor. I'll just quickly show you that. This is a motor with a LM393 driver circuit, a DC motor. Okay. So code is already written for this. So pin number 7 and 8. Okay, these are two inputs for this driver. If both are low, motor will be stopped. If one is high, one is low, then motor will start in one direction. Then interchange them, low, high and low, then motor will run in another direction. So a separate supply is required for the motor. So you also have a 9-volt battery available. And you won't be able to see this. 1 minute. See, can you see this motor rotating? So there are two things written in that, one with slow speed, one with high speed. And if I want to change the direction, then I want to make changes in the code. Right now it is rotation in only one direction. Okay. And you have temperature sensors, I think, is available, but I think PIR sensor is available with your Tinkercad. Okay. So I will skip Tinkercad now and I will come to the next platform. So WalkWee platform. So in this, I will just show, as I said, you have to go to walkwee.com. So initially when you go there, as I said, this is a front end for that. It's a home. A lot of programs are already done. Let's go to Blink quickly. So I don't think you can see this. What can I do? Okay, 1 minute. I will just see this window size. And what idea I can do is, but I cannot do zoom here again. Mm. Can you see this pin 13 is written here? I am not sure, but I'll just read it out. That's why I had taken snapshot in my PPT. Here there is a 13 pin written, okay? And code is already written here. I can also copy paste code from my Arduino IDE here and it will run, okay? So when I say run code, you can see here a blinking is happening. See, can you see this? Okay, so my LED is running. Now, this is inbuilt circuit done. There is no Arduino shown, only pin is shown. Now I want to change this pin to 7. So what all things I need to do here? Okay, so by default, they have not kept provision to change the pin here. So what I will do, I will stop here the program. I will go to my LED blinking program from my Arduino IDE, okay, which I already tested. I will take my program here and just paste it here. Now in my program, here it is 13. I want to change it to pin 7. So, okay, I just change the code. But if I try to run, it will not recognize this pin 7. Let's see whether it recognizes. Is it coming on and off? No, my pin my LED still shows that it's connected to 13. So though I change in my program, I need to change somewhere else. So just stop it here. There is one supplementary file given with .md extension. In this file, see, this is basically a Java-based code, okay? So you have different files with a lot of programming. If you want icon to show, then there is an icon file. And each icon, each element has its own name. So if you want to use this simulator, one need to really study what this file means. So now just for the demo purpose, I will show you 1-2 files. For example, in this particular file, we have one sentence. I'll just zoom. This is. Okay, you can see this LED. Okay, label equal to 13. Now this LED label, I need to change to 7. By that way, I am programming that my LED is attached to not pin 13, but to 7. Okay, so after this, now I come to my sketch. Here there is 7, here there is 7. There was only one place where I could give. And now let's see if I try to run. I have to minimize it since the LED is gone out of screen. Okay. So now if I now you see the 13 pin is changed to 7. Now if I run, it should work. See, it's working. So I modified my program, right? So now I have a control over simulator, right? Fine. So now I want to run 2-3 LEDs and there is no circuit in front of me. So then I need to really study this. How can I add another LED here in this tag style structure? How this what type of structure, programming structure, what we follows, that one has to really study. That everything cannot be demonstrated. Okay, so these are the small ways I can only demonstrate which file change, if I want to change icon, which file to change. Okay, so let's take one more program on this. I think I have time is up. I don't know whether I can get 5-10 minutes extra. So let's take LCD. Right. Instead of LCD, I think faster will be a keypad I will take. So detection of keypad. So if you go to this file, you can see there is an Arduino Uno board there. So then I can judge now. If I want my Arduino Uno board icon to be shown, I need this statement, which was not there in the previous program, right? I also have a keypad. Same way I can also have LEDs, LCDs defined here. So whatever components you want to show on the workplace, you need to define under this div tag, basically. Okay, we have to learn to define them and then they are available. So this is one way to show icons. And to give the connectivity, again, there are various ways to give. So let's come back to my sketch, okay, which is my program here. In the program, it is row and row numbers, and this keypad is row and column structure. So my all rows are connected to 2, 3, 4, 5 pin, and 7, 6, 7, 8, 9 is used for columns. And what program does by running it is only displays the pin connected. For example, if I click on 2, so okay, so here it will be shown. I still have to minimize it. Yes, it will display 2 here, then 5, okay, or a star. So likewise, it is just checking whether this matrix combination which is connected to Arduino pins is working. Now I have a facility here. I can just reverse this 2, 3, 4, 5. I can make 5, 4, 3, 2. What will happen then if I reverse rows? So when I press 1, a star will be printed. When I press 2, 0 will be printed. Okay, so I can modify this code and check that my rows are changed, okay, which is the right combination that I should use. Okay, so likewise, now I'll stop this particular. I want to show you one more program. So you can go any of the programs here. They have different components. As I showed, there will be LCD available. LCD program is ready. You can modify this program, right? Then you have 7 segment displays available here. It's not so visible through presentation, but then you can define the connectivity, change the connectivity what is given by default. So likewise, this tool can be really used for teaching learning. And if you go to Arduino libraries from here, then you have many sensors. Quickly I will show you a temperature sensor demo, how it is available. Okay, so it is DHT library. Let's go to this DHT sensor library. Okay, we have some DHT tester code. So if I zoom this code, then in this code, same thing is there. We are just importing DHT library. In the setup, we are defining pin number 2, that some particular pin where your analog pin or digital pin where it is connected. So I think it is connected to one terminal is to 5 volt. Define DHT or DHT pin, where it is defined, it's gone up. Let me tell you, DHP pin in this program is pin number 2. It's a digital pin, pin 2, see here, right? So if I zoom this, okay, so I am able to zoom this circuit, right? So there are 3 terminals we need to use: positive, negative, and a control pin. Now the beauty of this software is, see how they simulate it. I start the simulation, okay, and it's printing on the serial terminal. Current temperature is by default 24 and humidity is 40%. Now I can simulate this. I can click on this sensor. So see, it provided me 2 control. Now in default 24, I just increase. So I increase the temperature to 46 degrees, 46.2. So is it showing? Yes, here it is showing 46.2. Okay, and I default 40% humidity, I will just change it to something 80, 86 something. So see, it has changed my reading. So through these tools, we can really teach students. In actual real life sensor in IoT, you will have similar kind of thing. Only thing is, this will be environmental parameter. Environment will be changing your temperature and humidity. Here we are simulating that environmental status, we can see. Okay, so this is all about WalkV. And I think my time is up. I should stop here. Just a minute, I'll just stop this. Yes, coordinators, can you just tell me?
Ma'am, we are privileged to listen to your talk today, ma'am.
Yes.
Begin with a question answer session. We have one question from the Farhana. She is asking, what steps can be followed for data acquisition in IoV?
In IO?
IoT.
Yes. So data acquisition is basically, you are talking about that you have some inputs, number of inputs, that is sensors. So first step, you need to see you have sensors with you of proper specification, and you should be aware, if it is a temperature sensor, one should be aware of what is the range of temperatures. It is mapped with corresponding range of my millivolts. So every sensor, why we are able to simulate the sensors on the simulators, because any real time sensor actually finally gives you either voltage or current. It converts it to electric circuit. So we need to know that mapping for every sensor. So I need a minimum temperature, let's say a 0 degree is mapped to 2 millivolt, and highest temperature mapped to, let's say, 20 millivolts. Then I need to know that range and a steps, like when 1 degree temperature equivalent to how many millivolts. So some kind of mapping we need to know every sensor ke liye. Then sensor need to be connected, so we need to know whether they are analog or digital. Accordingly, we need to connect it to your smart board, right? Then we need to program them, and we need to read. So we, if it is analog read or digital read, then after that step, once you read it, you need to either store it somewhere or directly process it and print it, send it for the output, either for the printing or by using that input sensing thing, sensing data. You may need to control something, output relay, you want to switch on off something, some AC or some other device, right? So steps basically connect the sensor, know the parameters of it. According to the parameters, we need to, because these parameters are required, when we get the data, we must be able to find out the meaning of that data. That millivolts is equivalent to how much temperature, and that much we need to display. According to that, we need to display. So I think that's all is required, and if many sensors are there, then you may define it maybe to store them in the database, store in the Excel sheet, store on the cloud, depending upon what is the scope of your project. Yeah, I think I cleared the doubt.
Yes, ma'am. There is another question. Which simulator is better, because Tinkercad is not providing all sensors?
Yes, that is why I introduced WalkVie, because students will have internet connectivity and you have online classes. That time you can just open in another window WalkVie. Only thing is, you have to take little more pain, since it's very, very complicated. And as I said, I read somewhere that it is the best simulator for 2020. People must have used it, and I tried to use it just few days back, you can say, and I found myself where to change the code and how I can put my code there. There is a something called icon based concept. So I feel online simulator, if you want a sensors facility, you can go for WalkVie, and it also might provide you the ThingSpeak connectivity. I didn't have time to check that. So that is online, and if it is offline, as I said, SimulID is one of the free simulator. It's fantastic. Unfortunately, today I could not take it because I put some another simulator. Okay, but it is very self-explanatory. That is why I put the programs. Please go through those programs. Just download that simulator and you can do it. So one online and one offline you can use. Offline doesn't need internet and it is free of cost. So I feel that's better, right? But it doesn't have much sensors in that. There is only, I think, ultrasonic sensor there. So if it is sensor related thing, then you have to prefer online or paid simulators like Proteus or MATLAB.
Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am, for guiding us for the IoT journey.
Yes.
On behalf of Shan Ankar Kachhi Engineering College, I have a small token of appreciation here for our speaker, Dr. John Go, accepted with our sincere thanks.
Yes. Okay, I thank you, all of you also, for giving me this opportunity, and also I thank participants for their patient listening. Okay, thank you. Can I disconnect now?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye bye. Take care. Yeah.
Bye, ma'am.
The next session will start at 3:30. The link is sent to all of you on the group as well as on your emails. Thank you. We are closing this session now.